Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to the Atheist Experience. It is March 21st. Or is it the 22nd? Is it 21st?
I concur.
Which one?
21st.
21st. Okay, it's...
Yes.
Okay, then, March 21st, we are live. I'm your host, Ashley Perrien, and my co-host this week, despite what the credits said, is actually...
Did they
Jeff
not?
D.
All this fiddling with microphones and
yes,
whatnot.
And unfortunately, we didn't update the credits yet.
Who am I this week, then? Who did say I was?
According to
I was scribbling notes.
According to that, Karen.
Oh, cool! And a sex change for free.
So
thank you, Atheist Experience.
Jeff D., our co-host for the week.
Hi, everybody.
We are sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We have weekly Sunday mornings meetings, which are currently in a little bit of flux. We're a traveling atheist roadshow right now. This week we were at the Austin History Center, the third Sunday of every month. We have a lecture series at the Austin History Center on 9th and Guadalupe. That starts at around 12:30, and that was today. Alan Campbell was our speaker, talking about Exodus the movie, which is about the founding of the modern day Israel. I didn't actually make it this morning, but I heard that it was a fairly good lecture. So, our normal lectures, we do have one every Sunday morning, but like I say, it's in a state of flux right now. We don't actually know where it's going to be next week. We're changing it. It's what?
Crescent City Beignets.
Okay, apparently it's at the same place that it was. Crescent City Beignets, which is on 6th Street. I want to say around 1200 6th Street, West 6th Street. And that starts around 10:30, 11 o'clock, something like that. As for other regular things that we do, every Monday night we have Godless Gamers at the house of Russell Glasser. That starts around 7 o'clock and we play board games, card games, role-playing games, anything that happens to catch our fancy for the evening. That's every Monday night. If you go to our website, atheist-community.org, they have a link there to you can email the webmaster. And he usually has information on all that kind of stuff. He can get you details if you need that. Apart from that, that's on Monday nights. On Thursday nights, we have Atheist Happy Hour at Antonio's Tex-Mex, which is on the southbound feeder of I-35, just south of 183. That starts around 7:30, and people trickle in and out all evening, so just come in there and look for a loud table of atheists, and that would be ours. Apart from that, this coming Saturday, we're having a special event. There is a Renaissance Festival in Smithsville, which is between here and San Antonio, basically, about an hour south. We're going to be doing that this Saturday. We don't have exact details on when we're leaving or anything like that, but that's going to be pretty much an all-day event. So, again, write to the webmaster or get on our email list if you want a little more information on that one. Other thing that we have, on every other Saturday, we have the Nonprofits, which is an internet audio show, which this man hosts. And Russell Glasser produces. Quick flash, did you catch him?
I'm back.
Jeff hosts that one. That is every other Saturday.
There's my name.
Okay. that is every other Saturday, and I believe it's this upcoming Saturday.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, well, are you having one this upcoming Saturday?
Yes, we are.
Okay. Okay, I didn't know about the Renaissance Festival. It could have been postponed or something like that.
I have not heard that we're postponing the show. So,
as far as you know, some of us are
not going to get to travel back to the Middle Ages in San Antonio.
Okay. So apparently there will be a live showing, and that's on atheistnetwork.com, 2 to 3:30 every Saturday. It's an MP3 stream. Also, if you have trouble getting to that, if you go to our website, again, atheist-community.org, click on the Nonprofits link. They have a link there to the live feed.
And also the past episodes
and
that you
yes,
can
about a half
listen
dozen.
To on demand.
Yeah, about half dozen or so of those. That is all of that. One other thing that we announced, University Atheist and Agnostics. That's a registered UT student organization, and they have been going on for about two and a half years now or so. You can get more information on their group at uaandA.com, and they have meetings every Thursday. Check the website and get details on exactly where and when there. All right, I believe that's it. One thing, actually, I'm sorry, I keep coming up with things to announce. I have been forgetting to mention our email address for the last, like, month. we have an email address for the show, tv@atheist-community.org. If you don't get a chance to call us up, or you're hanging at the end of the show and we just didn't manage to get your call, you can write to us like that. And like I say, we'll put those email messages up on the website. If they're good, we'll reply to all of them. And if you have any ideas for shows, what we can do, any improvement, feedback, anything like that, write us in and we'll take it into consideration. So, anyway, that is truly well and it for the announcements this week. Again, it's March 21st. We are live. We have reruns every Tuesday at 4:30 on the same channel. What we're going to do now, though, is go over to our new rotating co-host, Jeff D., and find out what he's got for us this week.
Well, I was scanning the news recently and came across an interview with Democratic presidential candidate John Kerry, the presumed Democratic presidential candidate, right?
Potential future POTUS.
Isn't there still like some formalities they have to go through before the party officially nominates
him? I think
it's
like Illinois or Iowa.
For all intents and purposes, though, everybody is assuming. Anyway, a while back, I'm not sure how many years old this article is, but he was interviewed by American Windsurfer magazine. Apparently, John Kerry is big on windsurfing.
Well, I know he's doing skiing this week. So
what? He's skiing?
I saw an article.
Was that in the news?
He's taking a week off right now to rest and relax before the real campaign starts. And so, yeah, they showed him on skis. So.
I don't care what our presidential candidates do in their off time, really. But he was interviewed in American Windsurfer magazine. This is before he became a candidate for president.
Okay.
But the subject of spirituality came up in this interview. And he asserted that atheists and agnostics have spirituality. He said, "Spirituality is a fundamental for us. I mean, it is the overpowering driving foundation of most of the struggles that we go through here on Earth, in my judgment. I am a believer in the Supreme Being, in God. I believe without any question in this force that is so much larger and more powerful than anything human beings can conceivably define. I think the more we learn about the universe, the more we learn about black holes and the expansion of the universe, and the more we learn what we don't know about, our beginnings and not just of us, but the universe itself, the more I find that people believe in the Supreme Being."
Well, the man knows how to ramble.
Yeah.
I don't get much out of that statement.
I gotta point out, nothing about black holes indicates that there's a God.
Yeah.
Nothing about the expansion of the universe indicates that there's a God. In fact, it appears that the more we know about stuff, just assuming that as time goes on we learn more stuff,
of course,
the fewer people believe in the Supreme Being,
because
polls are showing that belief in a God is dropping.
Hmm.
It's like doubled.
Yeah,
the percentage of the population that doesn't believe in a God is doubled in the last 10 years.
There's less of a need for a God to explain things when science is doing a fine job of explaining the natural world.
Apparently. So I don't... Okay, so the man's not a scientist, fine.
Okay.
Cut him some slack. He says, "I am a Catholic, and I practice, but at the same time I have an open-mindedness to many other expressions of spirituality that come through different religions. I'm very respectful, and I am interested. I find it intriguing. So I really try to learn more. I've spent some time reading and thinking about it and trying to study it, and I've arrived at not so much a sense of the differences, but a sense of the similarities in so many ways. The value system roots and the linkages between the Torah, the Quran, and the Bible, and the fundamental story that runs through all of this that connects us and really connects all of us. And so I've always been fascinated by the transcendentalists and the pantheists and others who found these great connections just in nature, in trees, the ponds, the ripples of the wind on the pond, the great feast of nature itself." Not a scientist,
no.
But a poet of some kind.
Was this a like a written interview?
I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, this is one heck of a speech to just be rambling off, you know, on the cuff.
Well, if it was written, he probably wouldn't have said, you know.
Good point.
And back here in this when he was talking about black holes.
Okay.
And so I've always been, okay. I think it's all an expression that grows out of this profound respect people have for those forces that human beings struggle to define and explain. It's all a matter of spirituality. I find that even agnostics and atheists wind up with some kind of spirituality, maybe begrudgingly acknowledging it here and there.
Wow.
But it's there.
Okay. Perhaps on some of them.
I read this, and I wasn't sure whether I should be insulted or not. Because I don't know what he means.
Yeah. Spirituality is kind of vague.
It's extremely vague. I mean, it's black holes, and it's trees and ponds. And it's okay, the closest thing he comes to explaining what he means is profound respect for the forces that we struggle to define and explain.
Okay.
And then he says that's a matter of spirituality. He doesn't say that is spirituality.
Yeah.
He says it's a matter of spirituality. So I'm not sure. I mean, it could be that he's saying something extremely innocuous.
Yeah.
Or it could be the equivalent of saying, yes, well, you know, I know that all those Hindu people really want to eat cows as well. You know, I mean.
But earlier on, he also goes on about belief in a higher power and just the general. Some higher force or power.
Yeah, and there's that thing too. I mean, maybe this whole respect for the forces of nature thing that he's talking about, the transcendentalists and pantheists, maybe he's jumped away from that now when he brings in atheists and agnostics. Not that we don't have respect for the forces of nature. I mean,
of course.
Falling off cliffs kills us just as much, but. So I found myself compelled to try to figure out what the heck spirituality means.
Okay.
Because I want to know if I'm insulted or not. I mean, particularly when we're talking about potentially the next president of the United States. I'd like to know. And he'd like to know too, because he says he really tries to learn more. He spends time reading and thinking about this and trying to study it.
Okay, we'll send him the tape of the show.
And he goes on in the interview from this to broadening and saying, well, you know, it's all a matter of understanding how different people think.
Okay.
So that when you go into, like, international politics, right, relationships with other countries, you've got to be able to put yourself in the shoes of the people that you're talking to, understand where they're coming from, so you can, you know, reach some sort of understanding. Yeah. Okay, so here it is. I went to the handy www.dictionary.com. Typed in spirituality. Here we go. You ready?
Okay.
The state, quality, manner, or fact of being spiritual. Oh, that's a big help.
Okay. So look up spirit.
Spiritual.
Spiritual.
Spiritual. Of, relating to, consisting of, or having the nature of spirit. Not tangible or material, see synonyms at immaterial. Immaterial. Definition one.
Wild goose chase.
Of no importance or relevance, inconsequential or irrelevant.
Wow. Okay.
Now, I'm pretty sure that's not what they mean.
No, no.
And there is another definition for immaterial, the number two definition, which is having no material body or form. The first one's just funny.
Okay.
But I'm sure that's not what people who call themselves spiritual mean. They don't mean, you know,
nothing.
The state, quality, manner, or fact of relating to things that are completely unimportant. I'm sure that's not what they mean, even though a lot of atheists might agree. Having no material body or form.
Okay.
So what is all this?
Air has no material. Well, it's got
relating to,
matter.
Consisting of, or having the nature of having no material body or form. I still don't get it.
Yeah.
What do they mean? That's only the first definition for spiritual.
Okay.
There's a second one. Of, concerned with, or affecting the soul.
Okay.
Now there I can definitely shoot him down, because he might mean something like that, right? Atheists do not believe in a soul.
Yeah.
So we cannot have this relationship with souls because we don't believe in them.
Yeah.
Number three, of, from, or relating to God. Deific. No, we don't believe in those either. Of or belonging to a church or religion. Sacred. Nope. That's not us. Relating to or having the nature of spirits or a spirit. Supernatural. We don't believe in that.
Supernatural.
So, it's all those are just nonsense. It's got to be this first thing, right? Relating to or having the nature of...
spirit.
Of...
non-tangible
things
material.
Without any material body or form.
Okay, so would that
so
be
I
considered
think I've
your
got
consciousness?
A huh?
So, I would assume your consciousness. It doesn't have a material body or form?
Consciousnesses have material form. Consciousnesses live in brains.
It's a process.
They're a physical process. Well, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves. Okay. I did then go and look up spirit, right? Ready? The vital principle or animating force within living beings. Okay, well, not believing that there's any little ghostly beings inhabiting us, making us be alive, and instead going with the medical evidence, which is that it's blood pumping through our veins and electrical activity in the brain.
Yeah, vital forces, chemistry, and biology.
You can't stick atheists with that one. That's 1A. 1B, incorporeal consciousness. This is what we were just talking about.
Okay.
There is no evidence whatsoever, and therefore we don't believe, though apparently a lot of people do believe, that consciousnesses can be anywhere outside of physical processors like brains.
Yeah.
So that's not us. Spirit, definition 2, the soul considered as departing from the body of a person at death.
Okay.
We don't believe in one of those. 3, the Holy Spirit. Now that's specifically Christian. Even Muslims and Hindus aren't spiritual if that's the definition of spirit. Number 4, a supernatural being, such as an angel or demon, a being inhabiting or embodying a particular plane of existence, object or natural phenomena, or a fairy or sprite.
Okay, all those counted out.
5, is there anything we can call spirit yet? No. 5, the part of a human associated with the mind, will, and feelings.
Okay. Again, consciousness.
Example.
Your thoughts.
Though unable to join us today, they are with us in spirit. Now,
very bad quote to put with it.
Yeah. That's 5A. 5B, the essential nature of a person or group. Well, like, we agree that things have... there's ways you can describe stuff, and if you want to call that its essential nature, that's maybe putting too fine a point on it, but we think that people have, like, personalities that are distinguishable from one another. You could say that...
Well, yeah, I mean, we definitely have... the spirit of the ACA is such and such.
I guess we could. So. I guess we could say that. Would we say that, though? Or would we be getting into this quagmire of
perhaps
weird definitions, 90% of which don't apply to us?
Perhaps, but it could still be a relevant way of talking about something.
Number 6, a person is characterized by a stated quality. He has a proud spirit. Right? That's personality again, right?
Very similar.
Personality. 7A, an inclination or tendency of a specific kind. Her actions show a generous spirit.
Similar.
8, a mood or emotional state. The guests were in high spirits. It's personality and emotion, right?
Yeah.
That's the things in here that atheists actually believe in. Team spirit... spirit of 76, spirit of the law versus the letter of the law. That's like getting into these like implications, which is another thing, right? Alcohol. Okay, I know they don't mean that. Okay, so...
well, you never know.
All right. So what do we got? The thing that they... the theists seem to think, when they talk about spirituality, is having some kind of a emotional relationship with immaterial ghostly things.
Yes.
Right? They're, and I'm just guessing here, and if we have callers that can clarify this for us, that would be great. But atheists don't have that. You know, we may say that, you know, a person or group or organization or even natural force has a certain, we describe it, you know,
their qualities could be
their spirit, right? We might even euphemistically say, you know,
earthquakes are bad.
Yeah, or, you know, it was angry rumbles in the ground. Well, we don't mean that the ground is angry. We don't believe that the ground is angry. So we don't have any relationship with some immaterial force inhabiting the ground that that could be called an earth spirit that we relate to and make our decisions on the basis of that. At most, we'll recognize people got personalities and you know, concepts have... You set up like a legal system, and it's got a goal that may not be exactly what you get when you play out the letter of the laws there, and we could talk about the spirit of the law in that sense. That's it. So what did John Kerry mean? What did he mean?
By spirituality.
By atheists and agnostics have some kind of spirituality. Did he mean... atheists and agnostics recognize that people have personalities and will maybe euphemistically talk about, you know, nature in this anthropomorphizing kind of sense? Is that all he meant? I find it hard to believe that he left from talking about transcendentalists and pantheists.
I would kind of think that what he may be trying to do is, in a way, save us from ourselves or something like that, perhaps. In the idea that atheists have this bad rap in public. And so here, I'll go ahead and try and smooth it over a little bit.
Yeah, dude, that's not the way to do it.
They're kind of spiritual,
that is
too.
Not the way to do it.
No, it's not.
If that's what he's after, if he's trying to make nice, you know, the way to really make nice is follow through on this other thing that he said about really trying to learn and understand where other people are coming from.
Exactly.
You know, we don't... in any kind of sense that's relevant from a religious perspective, atheists do not have spirituality. Now, you'll find atheists, even in the ACA, I know members in our group who will say things like they have spirituality, right? But what they mean is just a vague kind of respect for nature. Yeah. But, to call that spirituality, I think, just makes the whole issue even more confusing.
Again, spirituality has a lot of baggage with it, just like saying that you are religious or anything like that, or you believe you're applying the word God to nature, and therefore, you know, you say, well, nature's my God then. You're adding a lot of baggage to that word, where you could just say nature. Spirituality has baggage, which
I would tend to agree. I would tend to agree.
So that
was a thing that... It was on my mind when I came to the show today. And like I said, if there's any callers out there can explain to us what, you know, believers mean when they say spiritual, I'd really like to know.
Yeah.
And I've actually been. I was a believing church-going kid for most of my youth, and I still don't understand what it was that was supposed to mean. Don't know. Sorry.
As in, what was supposed to mean?
Spirituality.
Spirituality at that time? Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
You'd think.
Well, yeah.
You'd think if you're going to the church and being involved, you know, and actually believing all that stuff, that somehow, somewhere in there, you'd get a clear idea of what was meant by that word.
Yes.
I didn't get that.
It is a rather vague term, to say the least. But yes, we will be getting calls in a couple of minutes. Our phone number, 477-2288. And again, if you have something to say on spirituality, that would be kind of nice. As for one quick thing before we get to calls, hopefully. Exactly. The movies this week.
Yeah.
A rather interesting turnover. The Passion of the Christ has been the number one leading movie for since it came out, basically, for the last, 3 weeks or however long it's been. I think it's up to over $280 million now, some ridiculous amount. But it's been knocked off the top.
I'll tell you, Mel Gibson not passing through the eyes of any needles anytime soon. Those of you who are
familiar with your Bibles
will get the joke.
Not with a checkbook like that. But yes, the top movie this weekend was not The Passion of the Christ. It was instead... Dawn of the Dead.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, still violence, still gory, still blood, still sacrifice.
And still about dead people rising.
Exactly. Lots and lots of ties between those two movies, actually, if you start to think about
there
it.
There are some surprising parallels. And there's actually you haven't seen the film yet.
I haven't seen this one, no.
But, you know, it's a remake, so it's not like I'm in terrible danger of giving anything away. There's a character in the film who insinuates, without any evidence, of course, insinuates that the reason why the dead are rising and coming and attacking the living in that movie is because it's God's judgment on humanity.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the reason that Jesus in the Passion of the Christ rises from the dead at the end is because that's God's judgment on humanity. It's just in one case, you know,
it's humanity's back door.
It's this nice happy man in a robe, and in the other case, it's like throngs of
brain
people with
eating,
brain-eating creatures with their flesh falling off.
The other one that I had with that, Jesus.
Yeah.
Sacrificed himself to save the world. Got beaten to a pulp, sacrificed himself to save everybody else.
Uh-huh.
In the Dawn of the Dead, it is the live humans, who are also the good people, who are, perhaps not willingly, but at least partially, sacrificing themselves up to the marauding hordes of zombies to perhaps gain everlasting life.
Yeah.
Life through immortality or life through unlife through deadness or whatever. You too can eat brains with the rest of us.
Quick movie review. On Dawn of the Dead.
Okay.
It has some nice moments.
All right. Well, I guess we can go ahead and take our first caller.
You not do news anymore on this show?
No, we don't. Did you bring any?
No.
Okay, then.
Let's go straight to callers.
All right, we have got Wanda. How you doing?
Yes.
Hi, Wanda.
Listen, Jeff D. makes a lot of sense, but I don't want him to act like Kerry is the only politician claiming a belief in God.
Oh, no, certainly not.
Because
they
don't claim that, they won't be elected, and they know it.
Well, I just want to... I was particularly struck by this one because the interview took place before the presidential campaign. And also, it was in American Windsurfer magazine, not a place where, where it's a big opportunity to get a lot of votes.
Well,
maybe in California.
Well, to be fair, maybe you should stay out of politics because that's part of their campaign. They never win without that.
That doesn't make it right,
though. For instance,
though.
George W. Bush said, "Our life is sacred."
Yeah,
but...
Bring that out.
But there's also the idea that, you know, religion and the government should be separated and should not be intertwined all that much.
Exactly.
And so the government, you know, any politician should not be out there saying, I want to get elected, you know, and God bless everyone who votes for me.
Yeah.
You know, that's not something that should be brought up.
Yeah, and by the way, I don't buy this premise that you absolutely have to be religious in order to succeed in politics. I mean, that may be the current climate, but you look just, you know, at New Zealand, there was a little flap when some of the members in their government started turning on each other, with one guy outing the woman who's the prime minister of New Zealand as an atheist.
That's New Zealand.
Well, no, I know things are different here now.
Even
but
if
there's
you look
no
at,
reason it has to stay that way. Yeah.
Even if you look at people like Jesse Ventura. He's not exactly, you know, the president or trying to be president, but he's doing fairly well, and he was doing fairly well. And, you know, while he's not exactly, you know, an atheist, perhaps, he's certainly not exactly a Bible-thumping Christian either. So he's had some hostility towards religion also. So,
and I should also mention the American Atheists has set up a political action committee specifically for the purpose of lobbying for atheist issues in Washington. So it is not as if there is no place for atheist viewpoints in government.
Well, I realize that we're going through a phase and we're ending it, I hope, that the primitive religion, you know, but for the time being, they don't dare depart from religion and expect to win.
Right.
Well, you'll have to face that.
But that's why folks like us are, you know, making a point of being out in public so that atheism can be something that's talked about.
I tell everybody about the program.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. Thanks for calling,
Wanda.
Okay. So,
yeah, I mean, the only way that we will continue to be in a situation where you have to pretend that you're religious in order to get anywhere in politics is by people who are not religious staying silent. So we don't do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Perpetuating the idea that you have to be religious. So. All right. We will get on to Jerry. How you doing?
How's it going today, guys?
Pretty well.
Hi, Jerry.
Just a couple of points, one of which was, from my understanding, the use of the word spirituality in this context tends to, and I think you touched briefly on that, be more that mystical, emotional feeling for experience. It doesn't really have any true application except for distant etymological.
Are you a theist?
I beg pardon?
Are you a believer?
No.
Okay.
But
so you're guessing like we are.
It has no actual close connection to theological beliefs.
Really?
In common parlance in this particular instance.
It's hard to see how not. I mean, having explored, you're right, we did touch on it, but then we went all over the map with, you know, tracking down possible meanings for it, so we'd have to have touched on it somewhere. But the vast majority of meanings that it looks like it might have something to do with believing in supernatural thingies.
Right.
You know, so, yeah. I mean, that has to do with religion.
It's just, I think, as I said, in this particular context, the meaning commonly now tends to more apply to a broader metaphysical, mystical experience of life rather than a true spirituality. It's closely tied into it from its derivation, but not so much the context.
Okay.
So well, general awe and wonder of nature and the universe and life and...
Right.
Ooh.
But he said metaphysical, right? And again, if that's what John Kerry meant, then he needs to study what atheists actually think a little more.
Right. The other point is tied to that, and you had mentioned the disembodied consciousness thing.
Yeah.
I think the best phrase I've ever come up against, and I think it was from T.H. Huxley, was him referring to them as gaseous vertebrates.
Gaseous vertebrates.
<That's>
sure, <a good. laughs> sure, right, because you can't be a vertebrate without, you know, a spine.
Exactly. So, at any rate, you guys take care. We'll talk to you later.
Thank you.
Thanks for calling.
Right.
Okay. All right. That's all we've got for callers right now.
Well, we can.
One thing I could go over.
Yeah.
Survey.
Oh. Yeah. Right.
Which is right here. This is by Coral Ridge Ministries, which we've had a couple things with them. They're the ones who, I believe, supported Roy Moore in his little fiasco with the Ten Commandments.
I want to talk about Roy Moore later too.
Okay. But essentially when he put up his Ten Commandments monument, they filmed it, sold the tapes to pay for his defense. A very sleazy kind of bunch. But they have put out their 2004 Spiritual State of the Nation survey, to deal with, you know, all the spiritual and moral issues that are kind of coming up in, you know, being an election year also. And they mentioned the history-shaping questions that are likely to be decided this year, such as federal judges allowing homosexuals to marry. And of course you could tell this is a very, very Christian organization when they say, Christians suffer increased discrimination in the courts and persecution in the public square.
Where is this happening?
Not in our universe.
What's happening is that for two centuries, Christians in this country were able to get away with putting up their religious symbols and religious claims all over everything because there weren't enough non-Christians in this country to raise a stink. Now there are, and the law that was always in place that made it wrong for Christians to do that is being enforced because there are enough non-Christians, finally, to raise a stink. That's what's happening. There is no persecution. What are the other words they used? Persecution?
Increased suffer increased discrimination in the courts.
Discrimination?
and persecution in the public school.
No, there is no discrimination. There's no persecution. The law, the basic principle of separation of church and state is finally being enforced because there's finally somebody on the other side of the issue interested in having their rights protected.
Right. Talking about the possible abandonment of our Judeo-Christian heritage, implying that we actually have a Judeo-Christian heritage
government. We have a heritage of having slavery.
Exactly.
Right? Have that we abandoned too. The heritage? No. We just don't have the slavery
We've
anymore.
We've decided against it. but that was all in their opening letter to explain what this thing is.
Uh-huh.
I'm just going to read a handful of the questions here. The questions really did range from, I mean, they had a couple of straightforward, non-biased, perfectly mm-hmm. good and fair questions. Do you agree with U.S. policies in the battle against terrorism? Whether you agree with it or not, you know, you can answer this. It's not a biased question mm-hmm. to any great
it's
extent.
It's not a trick question.
Exactly, exactly. Should schools teach about abstinence? Fairly straightforward question.
Teach about abstinence?
Because the question just before that was, should schools teach about contraceptive use?
Sure.
So it's relatively fair, those two. Then they've also got some that...
That lesson is going to be really short, though. Hey, kids, if you don't have sex, you won't get pregnant.
Makes it easy. But they do have a couple questions that kind of pique your curiosity just a bit. Should schools teach abortion as a woman's right to choose? As in...
Teach it. See, that when you say, should they teach abortion, they're approaching abortion as, like, a belief system or a viewpoint. Yeah. Abortion isn't a belief system or a viewpoint. It is a medical procedure.
Yeah. Yeah. What else? Should schools be required to teach our traditional American history, including our religious and moral heritage? Again, implying most likely that there is some kind of Christian history.
Should
it be taught?
I would tend to say though, because in the same sense, we should not pull the blinders over the fact that we used to have slavery.
Exactly.
We should not pull the blinders over the fact that that a lot of Christians, in particular, with a rather primitive view of ethics and morality, had a lot to do with founding our country.
Yeah.
Shouldn't hide that fact, but that's different from pretending that that is the basis of our ethics or morality now.
Of course. And some of these questions, you just have to be careful because you're knowing where they're coming from. Just like the first one. Do you support efforts to uphold the rights of religious freedom and expression in public life? Now, again, they like the term public because it means anything outside of your bedroom to them. Whereas to most other people, it should mean government-sponsored. As in, the government doing something is a public act.
Sure.
But putting up the Ten Commandments on your front lawn is not public in that sense.
And when I took this poll, I did have a lot of problem with that one.
Exactly.
Because it's way too vague. There are places where there are circumstances under which it is perfectly okay for a politician to mention their religious views. Mostly... when they're given their opinion about something.
Yeah.
I got no problem with them saying, you know, in my opinion, as President of the United States, blah, 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 about God. You know, that's their opinion. But when they go and say things like, God is on our side in this war, when they're making a statement of fact and presenting the viewpoint that their God is on our side, much less that he exists, as a fact... right in the face of millions of Americans who do not happen to believe in his God, then that's a problem.
Yeah, yeah. And then some of the other ones. Should students have the right to pray in public school classrooms at sporting events and graduation ceremonies? Implying in some way that they don't have the right currently.
They have the right to pray.
Exactly, they can pray until they're blue in the face.
What they don't have the right to do is take over that event as a religious exercise.
Exactly.
That's what they don't have a right to do.
Exactly.
Yep, that was another difficult one.
And of course, what they're going to do with all these questions is, if I go ahead and say, the perfectly logical thing is, of course, students should be able to pray at school. They can't, you know, do it over loudspeakers. They can't, you know, rope everybody else into praying with them. But if you want to sit at your desk and pray during lunch, before school, anything like that?
Sure.
Sure, go ahead, no problems. What they're going to do is run with this idea and say, yes, people think that you should be allowed to pray in school and that you can take it over to loudspeakers and you can, you know, have everybody else pray.
Well, they may.
And that's not necessarily...
If they get the results that they were looking for.
Exactly.
I know you covered in a previous show the...
American Family Association, I believe it is.
Their poll where they opened it up to the internet and they did not get the result they wanted, and so they reneged on their promise that they were going to take the results to the government.
Yeah. I haven't tried
There's been another poll much like that that I encountered. I think the other one was on a also on a gay marriage topic. I can't remember the details.
Okay.
But this one, I noticed, they weren't showing the results.
Yes.
They've learned to make their questions more vague so they can trick people into giving answers that they can twist to mean what they want them to mean. And they've also learned not to show the results so that if the results don't come out the way that they were hoping, they don't have egg on their faces.
Yeah, they can quietly put this away and not deal with it anymore.
No interest in the actual truth of the matter. No interest in what it is that people in America actually think.
Yeah.
They're only interested in generating some statistics so they can get their way.
Exactly.
Sad.
Exactly. So, all right. Let's see. We can come back to a couple of these if we need to. But you kind of get the idea with that one.
Hey. Callers.
Callers, yes. We'll go on to Celia. How you doing?
Hi, guys. How are you?
Hi.
I was calling because I know that you wanted some theists to call in about the term, trying to define the term spirituality.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think it's a lot more vague than the term religious. I used to be Southern Baptist, and so I would consider myself religious at the time, but now I'm not. So I use the term spirituality to mean that I really don't know exactly how to define my concept of a higher being, but I still believe in it. I'm not atheist per se. I guess a little more agnostic, but, you know, it's sort of a vague term to say that I really don't know what the hell I believe. that's just about what
I'm not sure. I am entirely sure I know what I believe. And so if John Kerry means by calling atheists spiritual,
we don't
know whether we really believe or not.
He's totally off the mark, yeah.
Yeah, that won't fit either.
Yeah. He's trying to, I don't know, maybe just bridge some sort of gap or, you know, exactly. There's just a lot of stereotypes about atheists and most of the stereotypes, or all of them, I guess, are not true.
Well, I'm not so worried about this as a stereotype. I mean, the guy does seem to honestly want to understand other viewpoints, and I'm cool with that, right? And I'd love to help him out when it comes to atheists. it's that... you know, you got to start somewhere, and when we have a term like spirituality that's so vague that, you know, you can call somebody spiritual and it's not at all clear whether it fits or not. I mean,
I think that
sort of bothers me. I want to know whether it fits or not.
Belief in a higher being, but that is not what atheists believe. So, I mean, it's totally off the mark.
Do you think spirituality has to that definitely is a reference to theism? Because
usually,
there's like Buddhists that don't have a god.
Yeah, but I guess they believe like in a higher consciousness or something.
Yeah.
I don't know if an atheist could be a Buddhist. I guess it's possible.
Well, technically, Buddhists are atheists because they don't believe in a god.
Interesting. Yeah, I hadn't thought about it that way.
Technically,
there's a lot to that goes along with atheism, though. That goes beyond that. Going back to what you had said earlier about having something to do with a soul.
Yeah.
Technically, you can have a soul and not need a god.
Sure, that we could
they're
be
they're
in a universe where
exclusive.
There are such things as souls, but there aren't such things as gods. That's possible.
So it's possible.
But there's not any more evidence for
soul.
One than the other, and so most atheists tend not to believe in souls either.
Yeah, so I guess it would just believe, like maybe a belief in some sort of place that your soul goes to after death, or I really honestly don't know.
Yeah.
All I know is how I define it for myself. You know, I've heard it defined in other ways, and religious people tend to get really freaked out when you use the word spiritual because they think you're talking about some new age mumbo jumbo and
really?
They don't want to define it, and so it's just hard for all of us out there.
Spirituality usually is someone who doesn't want to define themselves as being, you don't want to say that I go to this church or I am a Baptist or something like that.
I don't want to close off any of the avenues.
It's kind of a general, I'll say theist, and so you're spiritual.
Yeah.
So is that what that means?
So it's kind of like an in-between agnostic and Christian.
It reminds me of a scene from the movie The Mummy where this guy was confronting this undead being or whatever it was, and he held up a Christian cross, and that didn't stop the mummy. So he held up a Jewish star. That didn't stop the mummy. So like he kept putting up all these different religious symbols. It was pretty funny.
Wow.
Just, you know, he wanted to cover all his bases, basically.
Yeah. Okay.
I was some sort of help for you, but I mean, it's just such a vague concept. Exactly. You know, I think it just really means something different for everybody.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, but that makes it useless when folks like John Kerry want to say something nice about everybody, right?
Yeah.
If it's so vague that, it's vague enough to cover everybody except atheists, as far as I can tell, and yet he wants to apply it to us too. I'd love to come up with some happy, positive thing that he could apply to everybody that, you know, where we could be included and not raise our eyebrows and go, boy, is that really us?
Yeah, because, I mean, I guess you could also use it to, as a term to have maybe a respect for nature or a respect for human life or, you know, but anyone besides a sociopath has that. So why does it have to be the term spirituality?
I don't actually have that much respect for nature other than that, like I said, you know, falling off a cliff will kill me just as much as anybody.
Maybe an appreciation of a higher plane. I don't know. You know,
I don't have that.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what to do about that.
Respect of something higher. Again, it's almost back to spirituality, as in it's kind of vague.
Yeah.
As in, I'm into astronomy a little bit, and so it's really neat to get out there. Last night was a vernal equinox. It's kind of neat to just take a step back and realize what's happening and what's going on.
Yeah.
When I look up in the sky, I could see, you know, like five different planets up right now at night. Look through a telescope and you see this, you know, this fuzzy blob in the middle of it. But, you know, it's actually 100,000 stars all wrapped together in a little ball. That's kind of neat. That's kind of cool to realize what actually is going on there.
Definitely.
It's an appreciation of what that is and how much bigger it is, I guess, than we are.
But is that spirituality?
Maybe it's just like a sense of not being alone or something. It really is a vague concept. And I guess what spirituality means for me is that I'm not alone in the world in the sense that, of course, there's other human beings, other animals, other, you know, insects and stuff like that. But I guess I just have this sense that I was created by something. I don't really know what it was, or, you know, it's just so difficult to define.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I think what you're saying is pretty close definition based on everything else I've heard from people calling themselves spiritual. I think you're right. I think that's the sort of thing that it is.
Yeah.
But even though that's still a little vague, doesn't appear to apply to atheists.
No, I wouldn't say so. Yeah.
You know, we can look at a galaxy and say, gosh, that's cool, right?
Yeah.
But is looking at something in nature and saying, wow, that's cool, is that spirituality?
I don't think so.
I think it's good. I think it's a good, you know, reaction for people to have.
Yeah, sure.
Respect for human life, we got that, but like you said, everybody's got that. Is that spirituality?
Yeah, respect for a tree or, you know, something like that. I don't know.
We're still struggling to figure out what he meant.
Yeah, I guess you'd have to ask him specifically, but I guess it's better than, the swaggering, you know, guy that we have out there right now.
Absolutely.
Very pro-Christian. And
Whose dad said us atheists aren't even citizens.
You know, just shoving it in everybody's face and making it very clear that that is the right way to be.
Exactly.
You know. I agree. Yeah. I mean, I'm very, I'm glad that Kerry is trying to understand everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to help him along, because I think he's got a misunderstanding when it comes to atheists.
It reminds me of Clinton not this particular instance, but I'm reminded of Clinton when he was talking about, they were going through this whole, you know, Monica Lewinsky thing, and basically he kept referring to, that is between us and our God, I guess, and so I guess that I could respect that a little more than him, that if he were to say it's between me and God, you know, as if he is a supreme knower of what is out there. And
yeah, I personally tend to think it's between him, his wife, and Monica, but and nobody else's business. But oh well.
Well, thanks, guys.
Okay, thanks for calling.
Good luck.
Bye. Oh, yeah. I have something to say, but I completely escaped my mind now. Oh, I hate that when it happens. Okay, we have got Don, how you doing?
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Pretty well.
Hi, Don.
Yeah, I'm the partial, sometimes co-host on the show, and yeah, I don't know if it's breach of etiquette to call in, but...
No, not at all. It isn't, is it?
No. Thought I'd call in. My own definition of spirituality as an atheist is my sense of place in the universe. And I haven't revealed that to very many people, but I think that's a pretty decent definition and may capture the ideas that maybe John Kerry is trying to get across.
Okay. But I'm assuming you're meaning that there are things larger than you.
Yeah.
In the sense of, you know, rules of nature, planets, galaxies, yes, whatnot. And there are things below you.
Right.
You know, other animals, you know, plants, stuff like that. And so it's kind of like, you know, a hierarchy type system and where you fall in that hierarchy. But would that really be, again, going back to it, would that be spiritual?
Well, I mean...
I assume it's how you define
it. I think the question that raises for me is, well, will just any old place in the universe do as long as you have a sense of that you've got one? I mean, Hitler had a sense of his place in the universe.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So, I mean, I think you're probably more specific than that, right? You're probably not just any old place, but, you know, a certain range of places in the universe where you think it's good for people to think that they are.
It's good to be the king.
Yeah, well, I mean, sense of place, me in the sense of you know, appreciation.
Yeah, yeah. So that gets them back to that again.
Yeah.
See, and again, I think that's really where the line is between atheists and other folks on this issue, right? We'll look at some neat thing in nature and go, "Wow, cool!" Right? Yeah. Or be really interested in how that works, or, you know, and want to study it, want to understand it, think it's pretty, and want to just look at it. We have all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But what we don't have is going on beyond that and wanting, you know, leaping to the conclusion that somebody did that, and boy, we're glad they did that for us to appreciate.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Still trying to get a handle on it, but I think that's roughly where the division is.
Okay. Well, thank you guys.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, with into astronomy a little bit, I definitely like getting out there with a telescope once in a while.
Yeah.
And like I say, it's really interesting to go out there and again, you hunt for this thing, you find it, finally. And unfortunately, you know, it's a relatively small telescope, so most of the things out there, other than stars, just look like little gray smudges in the middle. But still, just to know that that's another galaxy.
Yeah.
Well, that's a cluster of, you know, 200,000 stars that's so far away. I mean,
yeah.
It's amazing. It's kind of a humbling, you know, thing to stand there and know what you're looking at. But in terms of thinking that it's supernatural or, you know, there's some kind of higher being to that, it...
The kinds of emotional reactions that we atheists seem to have are just different from the kinds of emotional reactions that theists seem to have when they, you know, when they're having a positive reaction to those things.
Yeah, we tend to assign a lot of importance to our own intelligence, and so day to day, I mean, I work with computers,
mm-hmm.
and so it's always seeing, you know, this is what, you know, our research and what we have worked on has produced this computer.
Mm-hmm.
And we can build buildings, and we can build bridges, and we can, you know, alter the landscape, and we can do all this kind of stuff that, you know, we know how to do.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, stepping back and finding out that, look at all the stuff that was happened without our interference. You know, look at how plants grow and how things, you know, how things happen that...
Sure. Billions and billions of years. Whereas you guys probably
not quite as efficient.
Designed that computer in like what, 2 years?
True. Not quite as efficient of a process, granted. But that would probably be the closest thing that I would say could be considered my, you know, a spirituality for me.
There is an aesthetic aspect to it.
Yeah, possibly aesthetic respect or
that, and seeing the respect thing.
Yeah.
I respect nature in the sense that at any moment some random natural occurrence could crush me like a fly. I got a lot of respect for that, right? And but that respect is respect in the sense of, you know, watching, you know, with the best of my ability to make sure I don't get myself into any of those situations. But there's all kinds of other things out of nature that I don't have, you know, I don't automatically assume, like a lot of the more nature-oriented religions that make their central point. And I guess even most monotheists who look at the world as the
intentional creation of their God, who set things up to work a certain way, because, and therefore that must be the right way, right? Nature, the nature religions will say, you know, that nature is the right way because they worship that, and yeah. Christians will say nature, what nature seems to be set up to do is the right way because God must have set it up to do that way. I don't have any kind of respect for that kind of stuff. I mean, I know human beings keel over dead in roughly, you know, 120 years maximum, and I think that sucks. I have no respect for nature happening to have come up with that little handy outcome. And I think we ought to change that medically as soon as we possibly can. But then at the same time, I can look at a cool sunset and go, wow, that's just keen. So I'm split on the whole respect issue.
Yeah. Okay.
Depends on what it is.
Well, let's find out what... Sue, what you got for us?
Hi, guys. How you doing?
Hey.
It's really nice to see you, Jeff. The last time you were on, I was in the hospital and I missed it.
Oh.
But I really enjoy watching when you're on.
Thank you.
My own idea on spirituality is real... I don't know, it's kind of the oneness of all living things, the fact that we all emit energy, things like that. And it's kind of what you were saying about the science and the, you know, I get it. But I was thinking more importantly that somebody like John Kerry would use the word spirituality because he doesn't want a word that's going to upset people like morality. I think he's trying to imply, well, atheists can be good people too.
So you're saying spirituality is a safe word, essentially.
Yeah.
Okay. So, again, going back to what I was saying earlier, possibly making nice.
Yeah, I don't think he wants to imply that he might think we're immoral, you know, by saying, well, they can be moral.
You know, I can't know what he meant, because it's just an, you know, a snippet of an interview, and he doesn't really explain it. But having done the... you know, a dictionary hunt to try to figure this out, I didn't see anything in any of the potential meanings for spirituality in, you know, looking it up in the dictionary.
Yeah.
That had anything to do with morality. Exactly.
Well, it's, someone was saying that we needed to have other choices for president besides white males. We should have maybe black people or women. I'm thinking maybe we should have a single man or an atheist or a you know, maybe we need to take baby steps, but maybe atheists would be too big a step. I don't know.
Well, someday.
Yeah. I don't know. I would like to know about their qualifications rather than their
Well, yeah, but it's like, look how long it took us to get a Catholic president.
Yeah.
Just for some reason, Catholic was awful. You couldn't have one. And we finally had one, and then...
And then they shot him.
Yeah.
Idiots.
That's what they did, yeah.
You know, even if... I'm not a big fan of Catholicism myself, but shooting them is the wrong answer. Wrong answer.
Oh, yeah. Well, thanks, guys.
Okay, thanks for calling.
Bye-bye.
Huh.
That's
another one, morality. But I'm writing it down in my little, you know...
Keeping notes.
...research, getting the feedback from the listeners, because... Because I'm still curious.
No.
And I don't see any reason why that shouldn't be thrown in the mix, and dictionaries are not absolute final word on what things mean.
Yeah. Well, spirituality, I've never really seen that as a direct tie to morality. You could still be a serial killer, but still, you know,
well,
have
in a sense,
ooh, higher power.
I think there's a sense in which the term spirituality is used in the sense of, you know, a spiritual person is one who stops and thinks deeply about things. And folks like that tend not to be so much axe murderers.
Yeah.
maybe that is a connection, yeah. Right? Sort of a wisdom sort of thing. But, yeah. You know, yeah. To me, I'm a big supporter of people stopping and thinking carefully about things, but to me, it's also important how they go about doing that, you know, what kind of logic they're applying to the things they're thinking about before I'm willing to slap a happy label on that.
Exactly.
You know, like wisdom or spirituality.
Yeah. Okay. All right, two quick things. Again, we are a live call-in show. We've got about another half an hour left. 477-2288. Give us a call and tell us what you think. Also, if you want to write in, tv@atheist-community.org. Like I say, we can always take emails. But phone calls are a good thing, and we will go to John. What you got for us?
Hello?
Hi.
Hello?
Hi, John.
Yes, you're there?
Yeah. So, y'all guys don't believe in a God?
Right.
Yep.
And, do y'all have a soul, an inner being?
Well, we either do or we don't, but we don't believe that we do.
Yeah. We would bet
of course,
not.
We could be wrong about any of these things, but, you know, we're just going by the evidence.
Until it's proven otherwise, we will choose not to believe in souls and gods.
But y'all have emotions, right?
Sure.
Well, yeah, but...
Feelings?
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. Y'all do?
Yeah.
All right.
We're people just like you.
All right.
Yeah, emotions are biological, though.
Yeah.
They're biochemistry going on in your brain. Yeah. That's emotions.
All right, cool then. Talk to you later.
All right, thanks for calling. Glad we could straighten that out.
All right.
That's a fair question. Don't laugh at the guy.
Yeah. So, but yes, a lot of that does come from brain chemistry, and again, there are good reasons that we feel happy, sad, and, you know, love and respect. And
there's also bad reasons, but...
Yeah. True.
But it's still brain chemistry.
All right.
Okay.
Let's see. One or two of these other questions.
Oh, yeah.
Why not?
From the survey.
Yeah. Do you support protection of the public display of Ten Commandments from the attacks of such groups as the ACLU? Now, again, public they're defining as anywhere other than, you know, your bedroom. Whereas
there's only a very limited number of places where they don't belong. Those
exactly.
Places are called, you know, public
government buildings.
Yes. Ten Commandments displays on your front lawn, at your church, privately owned park, any of those things, perfectly okay.
Yeah.
Nobody has a problem with that.
Yeah. We can't say anything, and we wouldn't. I have no objection to, I think it's Hobby Lobby. It is a very religious company.
Yeah, I know.
And they're closed on Sundays and stuff like that. If they want to clear out, you know, a center portion in their store and put up a huge granite monument, go for it.
Right. But of course, that's why I don't shop there.
Yeah. But again, we have nothing to say about that. It's in public. But yeah, they can do whatever they want.
Right. I don't shop there, but that's my choice.
Yeah.
Right? I don't want,
which is exactly the reason why they can put it up.
I get enough exposure to religious paraphernalia, you know, in the news. I don't need it. I don't need it for my local craft store either, on top of that. So, but that's it. I mean, I wouldn't go shop there, but... They have every right to put up a monument in their building if they want to, or have their little pointed comments posted on their door about, we're closed on Sunday so our people can go to church.
Yeah.
Well, that's fine. I find it silly and ironic, but that's their right. I'd never tear it down. I would never try to pass a law to tell them they couldn't.
Yeah.
They'll just go shop elsewhere.
Yeah. It's a private business. They can do pretty much whatever they want. That's legal.
Sigh.
Do you believe that some of the national media present anti-Christian programming under the guise of objectivity and journalism?
No. That was a clear no.
That's a pretty good answer, solid answer you got for that one.
What, do you think they were getting at something more subtle than that? I mean... You know what I mean? You turn on anything...
Do they present
10 times as many religious weirdos, right?
As any...
Extremist religious weirdos getting airtime on the news than you'll ever see atheists.
Yeah.
10 times as many. Yeah. Every once in a while you get a Ray Hyman from PsyCop or a James Randi or one of those guys. That's it. Every once in a while.
Yeah. And what is it? Should schools promote homosexuality as an acceptable lifestyle? Now, the schools typically don't promote heterosexual.
That's right.
As a lifestyle. I mean, they don't say that you should be getting boy girl. You know, that's a good way to go about things. they don't do that. And so,
but maybe what they mean—it's
more normal. It's
why
more
would
common.
They even bring this up unless they thought that what the schools were already doing was promoting. Heterosexual monogamy.
Yeah.
Right? They must think that that's already what's going on. And there's this tendency that I've seen for people on that side of the issue to leap to the assumption that simply talking about something is promotion of it. Right?
Yeah.
And not only that, not talking about certain things is
promotion of the thing
that they're not talking of the opposite view from the thing that they want to talk about, right? I mean, I've had Christians tell me that if you don't talk about God in public schools, then you're promoting atheism.
Yeah.
But that's not talking about God isn't atheism.
Well, didn't Roy Moore say that recently? You said you wanted to go.
Oh, I had this Roy Moore thing. You know what Roy Moore's supporters tried to do? I don't know if he covered this in the previous show.
No, but I think I heard about it on the radio.
Roy Moore's supporters tried to argue. They went back to the Alabama courts, and they said, you know that big empty space in the courthouse where the two-ton monument used to be? That empty space is a monument to atheism. And so that violates the separation of church and state. And you have to get rid of that by putting the monument back.
Can we just put like a taco stand there?
It was thrown out, but that is so nuts. It's so like
empty space.
Look out, Roy, there's an empty space behind you over there promoting atheism. not talking about religion is not atheism. There's all kinds of scholarship and books and opinions and education that could be disseminated about atheism if somebody had a mind to do so, right? But just not talking about God isn't atheism.
Yeah.
Not believing in any gods is atheism.
And telling people
they shouldn't believe in any gods, that would be promoting atheism.
Yeah.
Just having some empty space in the middle of your courtroom is not...
Putting up a monument to God, you know, there is no God. You know, belief in God is ludicrous. That would be a monument to atheism, possibly.
It would be a fair one. Sure, and the government should not be in the position of telling people not to believe in any gods.
Exactly.
But the government isn't doing that.
Exactly. They're taking out this very, very obviously Christian monument
and just not
replacing it with something else. That is not atheism.
It just makes me want to rip out my hair. When they come up with arguments like that.
Well, too late.
Wasn't that last time I was on the show, we talked about the amicus briefs in support of Under God in the Pledge.
Which oral arguments for that are this week.
Uh-huh.
That's on the 24th.
About to start.
That's on the 24th of March. And so, yeah, it's just, Tuesday or Wednesday.
Everybody
like
relax. Newdow's criticism of that law is not an attack on Christianity. It's not prejudice against Christians. It's not anything other than the playing out of the Constitution the way it was supposed to all along. The only reason it ever got this far is because Christians are used to a society where the percentage of Christians was so high that they could do that stuff and nobody would ever challenge it. That's the only thing that's happening.
Yeah.
If you don't like it that there aren't so many Christians in our society, you go right ahead and do whatever you want to within legal limits and ethical limits, please, to convert people to believe in your religion. That's fine. Yeah. You had every right to do that. But it's not an attack on you.
Yeah. Argument and debate is something that should be promoted. So getting ideas out there and, you know, learning about different points of view, whether you agree with them or not, is a good thing.
When I mean ethically, I mean like no more of this stealth Christianity going into public schools under the guise of what do they call it? Motivational speakers that are in fact Christians trying to get the kids in the school to go to their church.
Yeah.
It's underhanded and deceitful. If that's what you need to do to spread your religion, you may as well give up.
Yeah. So. Anyway, people, again, it's a live call-in show. It's Sunday, March 21st, and you can call us 477-2288. Like I said, we got a little while left on the show. Definitely want to take some more callers, so pick them up.
Yeah, we've gotten only one theist calling in trying to explain what spirituality means, and she was, you know, a generic theist. Believing that there is some sort of force like that, but not really knowing, you know, exactly what it is which is not at all representative of the vast majority of organized religions.
Now, I'd like to tell us a whole lot. Have some Christians calling in and tell us, again, what do you consider spirituality to be versus religion, for instance? I'm assuming those are two different grounds and two different topics, so... But yeah, finding out what the spirituality side of things would be kind of
Huh.
Kind of interesting. All right, we will go to Judge. What you got for us?
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
How you doing?
First of all, I am a god.
You are
not?
A what?
No, I'm a recovering Catholic, man. It's okay.
Okay.
The one thing I don't agree with, I am a devout atheist.
Okay.
There was no god.
What does that mean?
Man would have created one, you know. But I'm not out there preaching it. I don't think it's my my duty to go out there and push my trip on other people.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't think it's right for Christians or Jehovah's Witnesses or... Okay. Oh, God, I can't even believe I said all that. But, to push their trip. And I'm not out there to preach to anyone. Everyone should do what they want to do within their own faith.
Mm-hmm.
And even though one man's religion is another man's belly laugh.
Yeah.
I don't think we should be out there being called terrorists like we would be if we were out there preaching atheism to everyone else.
Yeah. Ooh, yeah. Terrorists.
But well,
people don't call people terrorists nowadays at the drop of a hat, right?
Yeah. But, I don't want to start on that one, okay?
Yeah.
But, I'm sorry, you have something you want to take this first?
I agree with you in, hate to use this, but it's a word that comes up right now, in spirit.
there's another.
But,
okay, that's enough.
But, I mean, I understand what you're trying to say, as in nobody should be pushing their beliefs on other people, and while I agree with that, in a sense, if everybody agreed to that, if everybody would just have their religion, live their life day to day, and realize that it's their own personal private beliefs, then I'm all for it. That's perfectly fine. The trouble is, most people don't agree with that, especially the religious people. They have their idea that, you know, we have this religion and it's supposed to be promoted, we're supposed to spread it because, you know, it spreads happy, happy, joy feelings. Now, the problem with that is that they then get airtime, and they get a lot of promotion for their side. And if we didn't at least get out here, then the other side of the coin would not be explored at all. We're here partly as education, just to say what your Baptist preacher is telling you about atheists, probably not the right words. And so we're out here just to say, we're not here converting anybody.
Or your...
The point of the show is not to convert anybody.
Or your Democratic presidential candidates.
Oh, no. May I respond?
Yeah. Okay.
I'm not saying the show itself is doing that.
Okay.
There was a comment made that we should get out there and tell everyone that there is no God and that, you know.
No, that comment was an example of what the government could do to promote atheism that would be just as wrong as what it's currently doing.
As what they're currently doing with Christianity.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Exactly.
No, the government shouldn't do that.
If you look at things historically, the Greek, the ancient Greeks, the problem that they had, it was probably one of the best governments that ever existed. But what they started doing is putting laws on people's morality, as we do in our government as well. The Christians are running my life,
nah.
And they should. A dry cleaner can keep his store open for 24 hours, but a person that sells alcohol can't because of some morality belief or the Christians.
The old blue
it's not
laws.
Right. Where is that separation between the church and state? There isn't.
Yeah.
With Sundays and dry counties and, oh, God, I can go on. And I don't want to, but I appreciate your time, guys. Thank
you. Thanks. I do want to respond to this whole question of promoting atheism, right? Because this comes up periodically. And here's the way I look at it. It's not against the law for Christians to go out and proselytize, and it shouldn't be, right?
Yep.
And because it would be extremely creepy if we tried to institute laws to prevent people from encouraging others to believe the same things they do.
Well, that's freedom of speech, basically.
We need the ability to encourage other people to believe as we do to pass on, you know, information that happens to be true. I mean, that's what schools do. We teach little kids stuff we happen to know is true. Now, you could put in laws to prevent people from pressing beliefs that are not true, like we have laws against slander. If you say things about somebody else that happen to not be true, that defame them, that's against the law. And also, what do you call it? you know, you have business practices. You claim you're going to sell one thing to somebody and you sell
false advertising.
False advertising. There is a term for that. Right. I mean, those specific cases we have covered. In France, they have another law, which I think is excellent, which says, and it's not the headscarf thing, because I think that's a travesty. people should be able to wear whatever silly headgear they want. But they have a law that makes it illegal for proselytizing to occur when the target of the proselytizing, the target of the preaching, is in a when they're in a vulnerable situation, right? They're poverty stricken. They've had a death in the family. All those things that religions love to jump on as opportunities to convert people. That they made all that illegal, and I think that's an excellent idea, because the problem, in my view, is not the mere act of trying to get somebody else to see things the way you do. I think everybody has to have that right. The problem is when people use trickery and deceit. You know, I mentioned the stealth Christian motivational speakers that are stalking our public schools these days. There's a lot of those things going on, and it's just despicable. That is something that should stop. But that's the problem. It's not the mere fact of trying to convince other people to see as you do. We do a certain amount of that on this show, right? I mean, just like anybody else, when asked to explain our viewpoint, we will. And when you do that, you can't help but be in the middle of an act of attempting to get somebody to see things your way. Yeah. And I don't think that we should either shy away from that or be embarrassed about it.
Yeah. All right. We shall go on to Steve. What you got for us?
Hey. This whole idea of spirituality.
Yeah.
I think that it comes from the fact that a lot of people, I think, really do live and kind of judge things by their emotions more than intellectually. Like, the experiences they have emotionally are what is really the core of what their existence or how you explain it, how you explain what causes that or what's going on is the difference, I think, between believers and atheists.
How you explain
the experiences.
How you explain
the emotions,
what emotion
you're
is.
You know, why you're feeling certain, you know, in other words, your reaction to the world emotionally. You can come back and go, okay, why do I feel that way? Now, I'll give you an example. I have a feeling sometimes the best described is gratitude or gratefulness. Okay, you know that's a good feeling where I'm glad, and it's like I want to thank somebody because things have gone my way. I know there's nobody to thank, and I think it's because I'm evolved as a social creature. And that my emotions are built for interacting with other people, that when I feel happy, I want to thank somebody, and even when there's nobody there.
Yeah.
I can explain that. But the feeling is very powerful. I feel it quite strongly. And, you know, to describe it, that's the best way for me to describe it. So I think it could be that some of this spirituality is, that word gets used for sort of emoting when there's nobody else there. And reacting when there's nobody else there, as if there was somebody there, and it kind of implies a belief in a God. Excuse me, but it doesn't. Yeah. I mean, it seems like it would imply a belief in a God, but it doesn't really mean you have to.
And, right, you can have the feelings, but consciously be aware that.
Right, and I think that's the difference. And it worries me a little bit. You said something earlier that, you know, atheists have emotions differently than the rest, and I don't think that's really true. I think
if we said that, we were just flailing around wildly.
I know. I'm not trying to make a big point there, but I do worry that we don't share enough that, you know what, all these big, powerful feelings of awe, kind of emotionality or whatever it is, are experiences that everybody experiences, and a lot of people use the fact that they have that, you know, is really the reason why people end up believing in things.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you don't really think about it, you think, how can I be grateful to the world outside of me if it wasn't there to be grateful to, you know, if it wasn't another being?
And in fact, I've heard that and that exact sentence used as an argument to
or
prove that a god exists.
Exactly, but it's more because we're kind of built to react to other human beings, and so that's and we're smarter than we used to be. I mean, we've evolved our way along, and so now we're kind of realizing things beyond just the other human beings. Yet we're still responding to it with our kind of animal emotions.
Yeah, we have this idea that again, when somebody when you're in a little tribal village and somebody brought you a skinned chicken or something like that, it's kind of a nice gift. You thank the person for it. And now, when you've got that same kind of, thankful built-in emotion for having, fields of fruit or something like that and these, really big things in your life to be thankful for, well, it must be some kind of really, really big, powerful person up there to be thankful for.
And I just want to make sure we don't forget to share with people that, hey, we really do feel these things. Yeah, we can explain them as biochemistry. If you do that real quick, when you say, yeah, emotions, that's just biochemistry, it seems like you're basically saying, I am like, Data or something in the Star Trek show, and I don't really feel them. I understand what they are, but, we're not different in that way.
Yeah, it's possibly a different understanding of what's happening. But, yeah, I mean, I still have all the same feelings that everybody else has, religious or not.
And it's not in the dictionary definitions, but I really think that spirituality word somehow is hooked in with this emotional thing. I think the soul, when people talk about the soul, I think it's that center of emotion and experience that makes them think they have one.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And anyway, that's my 2 cents worth.
All right.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Sean.
That's the fifth thing I've written down. No, and that's the thing. It's just this big catchphrase for a whole bunch of stuff that's sort of loosely interconnected and and stamped with this giant single term.
Yeah. Hmm. All right. We will go to Ted. What you got for us?
Hey, fellas, I just really want to appreciate y'all being a voice of reason in the wilderness out there. Pardon the pun there.
Thank you.
Because I used to be a member of an evangelical church about 13 years ago, and guys, I am still coming down from that. I mean, it's a brutal form of mind control, especially the Pentecostal version. Just brutal.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, fellas, the question I had for you was, excuse me, I'm a little bit nervous. Have you guys noticed in a paper I'll read from time to time about missionaries being killed over in Iraq?
Uh-huh.
And I'm wondering, what in the heck? That's not the right word, but you know what I mean. are they doing over there? And how are they over there without being, are they flown in by certain people, or what's going on? Because I'm thinking to myself, come on, I saw the same type of thing at the church I was at. I'm not going to get into the church I was at, gentlemen, but I can tell you this. They were promoting, they were receiving messages from God on Monday morning and telling new people, especially young men and young women, who to marry
six months later
in the church.
Yeah. Wow.
And it is really crazy. And even today, this church is growing. It's grown like three times the size that it was when I was at it 13 years ago.
Uh-huh.
But my question is, what do you think is going on with this thing with Iraq over there? I'm beginning to think more and more and more that it's a religious thing.
Well, it absolutely is a religious thing. I mean, it's like I was saying before, religions love to target people who are vulnerable. That's one thing, right? And then there's also this impulse to go and eradicate opposing views one way or the other, right? And one way is to go and preach at them and try to get them to join your side.
Fellas, did you hear that it was a missionary couple, an older man and an older woman. They were Baptist elders mm-hmm. in a church, and the man and the woman were killed at a roadside stop sign by, I guess, an assassination team or some people over in Iraq. And they left behind one daughter and three sons. And I thought to myself, and they said they were over there to build a church in Baghdad. Yeah. And I thought to myself, good night, guys. You know, maybe first and foremost the priority if you want to believe that religious view, is that you're there to first and foremost take care of your children, not the guy halfway around the world.
Yeah. Well,
and I just, yeah. I don't know what to say, guys. I just wanted to get, I really value your opinion. You're a very reasonable man, and you really do provide a breath of fresh air, even if you don't have a lot of people that call.
Oh, we usually do. It's been so strangely quiet today.
Quiet today, but...
Maybe yeah. It's because I ask people to explain spirituality.
Yeah, forget it. I think what's happening is I think they're mixing that and morality exactly together. And you can't, when I was at the church, they would always tell me it is the grace of Christ, you know, that frees you. Well, what are these people doing around instituting more laws?
Yeah.
If it's truly grace...
If it's all just taken care of.
If God can do it, why do we need laws for it?
So, right.
You know, I'm sad to say, it all makes a kind of sense. If you believe all that stuff, right? If you believe, for example, world's about to end, did this church into that whole thing, the imminent apocalypse?
Uh-huh.
Was that one of their things?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. If you believe the world's about to end, and it's really a question of saving people so that they don't get tortured eternally, but instead get to be in heaven with everybody else forever, right? And you know your kids are already saved, well, of course you go and risk your life to try to convert some Muslims to Christianity. Of course you do, right? Because that makes sense in that worldview. That your life doesn't matter. What matters is going to be the eternity after you're dead, and right now is your last chance to convert as many people as possible. Makes a kind of sense. The only problem is that it's not true.
Yeah, I mean, it's unbelievable. And one final question, guys, if I may. Tell me what your feelings are about this Fox Cable News Network. I mean, the Fox Channel.
I am proud to say that the other day I walked into a bank that was showing Fox News on their TV monitor. Like 90% of every other place on the planet, apparently, that has a TV monitor for people standing in line to watch. And when I got up to the person at the register, I said, look, you know, could you just tell whoever is in charge of determining what channel that's set to that not everybody appreciates Fox's right-wing agenda?
Right.
They didn't change the channel or anything, but you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
I really appreciate it. Hey, and guys, just keep up the good work. You're a really fabulous man. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks.
Thank you. Bye. Yeah, I don't actually watch Fox myself at all. I've heard of all the horrors of it, but I don't actually watch it myself.
You go anywhere, and that's what they're showing.
Yeah.
Anywhere.
But for the 3 minutes I'm in the bank when they're saying, you know, this bombing happened today and three people
were
killed.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
That's biased, then, you know, no.
The bias is mostly, from what I've seen, it's mostly in the realm of their choice of people that they give talk shows to.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
Just all.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right.
And read Lies and the Lying Liars Who Tell Them by...
Yeah, I've gotten about halfway through the audiobook on that, and then
by Al Franken
picked that up again. So, but yeah,
astounding book and well researched as well as humorous.
Yeah. All right, we got about 2 minutes left. Don't look like we're going to be getting any more callers today. But again, tv@atheist-community.org. If you have something else to say or think something during the week on spirituality or anything else to do that we might be interested in, drop us a note, and like I said, we'll read on the air if it's something interesting. Again, we are live. This is Sunday the 21st. We have reruns every Tuesday on Channel 10 at 4:30 to 6 o'clock. We have our Sunday morning meetings every Sunday at, currently right now, Crescent City Bagel, or Crescent City Beignets.
Beignets.
Which is, again, on 6th Street. Check out our website, atheist-community.org, and you can get a little more information there on our other meetings and such. We also have a couple email lists. Ask an Atheist. So if you actually want to get into a good debate or something like that, that may be the place to do it. Anyway, it was a really good show. Thank everybody for watching. Thank you, Jeff, for coming on.
Thanks for having me on.
Helping out.
I'll be on in like a month?
Thereabouts.
Okay.
Yep. Next week, we're going to be having Russell Glasser on. I'm not exactly sure what he's going to be talking about. I think he mentioned something about... Oh, it escapes him right now anyway. But he's supposed to be on next week.
So are we spiritual or not? I guess it depends what they mean.
Depends on the definition. And in a nutshell, I would probably say no, though.
Yeah, if they mean the same thing they mean when they say that a believer is spiritual, probably not.
Exactly, exactly. So, well, everybody, have a great weekend. We'll see you next week. And theists, we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong. Goodbye, everybody.